So, Cult of the Lamb came out, and like many of you, I was on that instantly. Before we get into the main topic of the video, I gotta say, while I love a ton about this game, there were two things that really disappointed me. The first being the combat, which is just way too mind-numbingly simple to be enjoyable after the first couple hours. It just gets repetitive. The other thing was the serious lack of interesting details about most characters. Like, there are all these quirky NPCs we meet at different points in the game, and none of them really have any meat to their bones. It's not really that kind of game, I guess, but it feels like it should be. Even the main story of the game is fairly simple, and most of the lore is like 25% there. What do I mean by that? It's like the devs give us 25% and expect the other 75% to be speculation, or it just doesn't exist. That being said, one of the most notable story elements in this game that we do get is The One Who Waits and the Gods of the Old Faith. 5 becomes 4, becomes 3 becomes 2, becomes 1 becomes none. We hear this a few times throughout the course of the main game, which is really the biggest thing we have on The One Who Waits. You see, the four bishops that we are tasked with killing are all part of the original religion that dominated this area. And while there were many gods in the old days, there were 5 main bishops: Leshy, Heket, Kalamar, Shamura, and most importantly, Narinder. All were leaders of the Old Faith, which we actually don't know much about, but regardless, Narinder eventually broke off from the Old Faith in order to start his own heretical sect. But all of this happened over a millennia before the events of the game. Where we pick up at, the four bishops have been going on a sort of killing spree and hunting down every being associated to a certain prophecy that's tied to Narinder. My guess is this prophecy is the words that first appear when starting the game: praise the Lamb, conduit to great power, promised liberator of the one who waits below. Yet, sacrificial beast, take heed, for a crown cannot sit upon two brows. However, this isn't confirmed to be the said prophecy. I only speculate because if it was, the fact that there isn't a lamb follower form in the game would tie into the bishops putting all linked to the prophecy to the sword. So if the prophecy starts with praise the lamb, the bishops basically murdered all of the lambs left, including you, to stop this prophecy. One thing that could be evidence against this is the fact that Ratu used to be a vessel for Narinder, but given the fact that he failed, it's possibly because he wasn't a lamb and didn't tie into the prophecy. Much like how each of the bishops represents something evil, like how Shamura represents war or Kalamar disease, Narinder is the representative of death. His form is that of a black cat, which of course is tied into ancient superstitions of death. However, it's because of this fact that Narinder had to be locked up. Each of the other gods represents some kind of change or movement, but death is never changing. Narinder yearned to grow in knowledge and power like his siblings, and Shamura, who was known for their wisdom, gave a gift to Narinder to help him succeed in his goals. This gift is most likely the Red Crown, which Narinder eventually gives to us to gain access to some of his powers. The NPC Haro is one of the main sources of lore for this game, and through this bird-like creature we learn that after gaining the Red Crown, Narinder started to attempt to defy the primordial laws of nature and change how death works. These tradition-breaking heretical practices started to sow doubt among followers of the Old Faith, and a new cult was formed around Narinder and the Red Crown. The other siblings grew fearful of both the Red Crown and Narinder, so they devised a plan to bind the God of Death to his own realm, to prevent him from having access to his powers or the physical realm. The ritual was difficult to complete, and Narinder inflicted a wound upon each god before finally losing the battle. These wounds seemed to be never healing, given how they still wear bandages to the time of the game. Leshy's eyes were gouged out, Kalamar's ears were sliced off, Heket's throat was cut, and it would have been neat if she wasn't able to speak, but then again, it would be less dialogue to work with. And they're gods, so maybe the wounds don't work like normal wounds? Perhaps the biggest loss was from Shamura, who was the one to originally gift knowledge and the Red Crown to Narinder. Shamura was known for wisdom, but they tragically lost part of their memory in the ritual, and we see evidence of how Shamura was affected when they often randomly repeat phrases like five becomes nothing and he was a bishop once back when he was called Narinder. The ritual was successful and death was locked away, bound by chains that could never be broken so long as the other gods remained alive. And then, like I said, Shamura received a prophecy that a lamb would be the final vessel of Narinder. So they spent 1,000 years murdering every lamb until finally, you are the last one. Not all of Narinder's power is lost though, because since you are sacrificed and die, all dead beings go to the realm of death. And it is here that the game truly sets off. The main game itself is pretty self-explanatory. Under the guidance of Narinder and using the power of the Red Crown, you slowly build up a cult and hunt down the bishops of the Old Faith in order to release Narinder so that he can continue attempting to break the primordial laws of death. And while the story so far is tragic, it's really the ending that gets quite dark. Because once you kill all four bishops, you have to remember that 5 becomes 4, becomes 3, becomes 2, becomes 1, becomes none. And there is still one left. Now you can choose to be sacrificed alongside your entire cult to return the Red Crown to Narendra, but that is obviously a bad ending and most likely not canon. The other choices left to you are to portray Narendra and either kill him or make him a member of your cult. However, just like Haro says, how does one kill death? So the murdering Narendra option is most likely not the canon ending either. Unless, of course, by beating him, the lamb instead becomes the god of death, possibly through the power of the Red Crown? We know that basically anyone can become a god in this world simply by gaining enough followers' faith to ascend, so it's not entirely unlikely. The darkest ending, and most likely the closest to a canon ending that we are gonna get, is choosing to force him to become a servant of your cult. Think about how long Narendra was locked away in the realm of death, just biding his time and waiting for a servant to rebuild his cult and free him. He gives his prized possession, the Red Crown, away, and the chains are broken. Things are looking up, and then the little shit betrays and defeats you. But not only that, you, who are immortal by the way, are then forced out of a position of power into simply being a measly cult member who must do the bidding of the person whose power comes directly from you. That's a fate worse than death. And this dude literally is death. The best part is, because he has the immortal trait, you can make this already living nightmare into a living hell. Have him slave away in a stone mine. Keep him locked up in the stocks all day to be mocked. Force him to eat an absurdly large amount of poop bowls. If you can do it in the game, it might be worth doing to Narendra. Or pull a complete 180 and marry this psycho. That's what's so great about the sim part of this game. It's not overly complex, but the chances for emergent gameplay are there for the taking. Maybe this fate isn't all that bad though. As was once quoted by a great cult expert, you have more fun as a follower, but you make more money as a leader. So maybe this is all just fun for the one who waits. Something cool to note is that Narendra gets unique dialogue for quests if he is spared. It's mostly fluff, but we do get a little more insight into the other siblings, like how Kalamar lived in fear of both the Red Crown as well as the One Who Waits, and more importantly, how while there used to be many gods back in the day, after defeating Narendra, you have become the last god remaining out of thousands in the lands of the Old Faith. What we've got so far from this game is great, and there are already announced expansions for Cult of the Lamb that will hopefully give us even more cool lore and insight on the history of the Old Faith. However, Cult of the Lamb seems to be more gameplay sim-focused than story, so we might just get things like new cult buildings and rituals, which is fine. While the bosses are fun, I find the dungeons and normal combat to be the worst part of the game, so I hope these expansions improve on those aspects, as well as adding a little more flavor to the unique NPCs of the world. What's your take on the story of Cult of the Lamb? Any glaring lore notes I missed? What do you want to see in the next updates? I do hope we get more to this story so I can feature the game more on this channel. Until then, I guess I could make a clickbait Negative Rings of Power video. Seems like an easy way to get views these days. I'll be slamming it for having such horrible things as narrative, character arcs, and even worse, women. No, like seriously, Legolas can run for leagues all across Middle-earth without rest and not break into a sweat or heavy breathing. But if Galadriel, a much more powerful elf, wants to make a big swim, that's where your suspension of disbelief fails?